It was a Monday in early spring, and I was in fourth grade. Mom took me to school early, and that meant free recess. Kids took to the playground without supervision. It was like Lord of the Flies without the conch or the futile attempt at establishing democratic governance. The weak cowered, the strong prowled. I expected to find my best friend, Jason Taylor, holding court by the fourth grade fence and sharing the carnal knowledge that we had stumbled upon Saturday at his house. But when I arrived, he was in the middle of a crowd, and he was turning purple. John Dunn had my friend, and I had a decision to make. I didn't know what had happened, didn't know why or how Jason had been caught. All I knew was that John Dunn had him in a headlock, had both of Jason's feet off the ground, and I could watch or I could do something. It all happened at Trinity Episcopal Day School, a private school in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. Trinity was an L-shaped cinder block building adjacent to its namesake church and separated from it by an 8-foot wrought iron fence covered in honeysuckle. The fence served as more than a barrier, however. Everything the church was, the school wasn't. The church was regal, stately, with tended gardens. The school was squat and low, its asphalt playground filled with steel gym equipment of the sort that one might climb up with 10 fingers and climb down with 8. If architecture proclaims mission, the mission of the church, with its stained glass windows and high spires keeping watch over downtown, was to inspire and awe and symbolize the greatness of God. The architecture of the school suggested that its mission was to turn out good little Soviets. But it was mine. It was my school, my teachers, my friends. Jason Taylor and I had to be best friends because we were Jason Taylors, and Jason Taylor stuck together. Our teachers tried various ways to differentiate us. For a while, I was big Jason and he was little Jason. I liked that one more than he did. Then it was Jason Lee and Jason Wayne. I didn't like that one. Only Mama called me Jason Wayne, and only when I was in trouble. But finally, in fourth grade, Mrs. Rhodes settled on JW and Jason, and that suited us fine. Now, fourth grade was a watershed, a kind of graduation. No longer were we lumped into activities and programs with first, second, and third graders and their tinker toys and share alike nonsense. No, we were men. It was time to put away childish things and focus on what mattered in life, avoiding sixth graders. And of all the sixth graders, there was one in particular, John Dunn. That's D-U-N-N, Dunn. And no, he wasn't an island. He was more of an isthmus, or a peninsula, or perhaps an archipelago. He was huge, and he was mean. John Dunn destroyed anything he could get his hands on. He ripped the head off of Jody Dildy's Stretch Armstrong, squeezed every drop of pink goo out of its neck, and gave the desiccated husk back to Jody. Any loose ball that came his way on the playground was thrown onto the school roof. His basic approach was that anything he touched was his, and he'd do whatever he wanted with it. Yet he never went in search of prey. He was too big for that and too slow. He was spider-like, waiting for that moment when an overconfident or inattentive fourth or fifth grader stumbled into his web, and then he would strike, tossing kids half his size around like rag dolls, and we were all half his size. When Laura Kate Jones didn't show back to school after one Christmas break, it was rumored that John Dunn had eaten her. And even when Mrs. Pay told us that Laura Kate had moved to Kansas City, she had no proof, and we believed what we believed. The Friday before that fateful Monday in early spring, I stayed the night at Jason's house, and we spent all of Saturday playing in the concrete drainage ditch that ran behind his house. We caught frogs and turtles, threw rocks at broken bottles, and threw rocks at one another. It was in this drainage ditch that we found a water-soaked and bloated Playboy magazine. Now, for a fourth-grade boy, finding a girly magazine in any condition was better than coming home to find a leprechaun riding a unicorn in your backyard. We were spellbound. We studied our text with all the care and attention of a scholar getting her first look at a Gutenberg Bible. Up until that point, we had assumed that a woman took her clothes off for the same reason a man did, for a bath. Yet there on the page, right in front of us, a woman was not only unashamedly naked, but apparently thought it entirely appropriate, preferable even, to be naked while changing the spark plugs in her Corvette Stingray. We couldn't wait for Monday morning. We had been gifted forbidden knowledge, and it was our duty to share it with our friends. When that Monday finally arrived, I wore my green Izod. It was the best shirt I had. In fact, it was the first piece of clothing I owned that was both made and worn during the same administration. I spent the Carter years in LBJ hand-me-downs. But now Reagan was president, and I had a green Izod. It was morning in America. Mom dropped me at school. I put my things in the classroom and headed to the playground. I saw the crowd, some shouting encouragement to Jason, some laughing at him. I saw Jason flailing and kicking, clawing at the arms around his neck and trying to break free. And I saw John Dunn. He was smiling. It was a smile that did it. I was at full speed when I left, and John Dunn must have caught sight of me because he dropped Jason and turned to face me, but it was too late. I caught him in the chest with my shoulder. I heard his breath leave him. As he fell to the ground, he grabbed my collar and ripped my green Izod in half. I stood over him quiet. As he tried to find his breath, I struck him hard. His nose ran red, and he cried. He hounded me the rest of the year. It didn't matter. I had beaten him. He had hurt my friend, and I hurt him back. These days, he'd have excuses. Broken home, glands, too much television. But back then, he was just mean and got what was coming. Because right was right, and wrong was wrong. Well, right is right, wrong is wrong. And I'd still trade an Izod for a best friend any day.